It's not that I'm supposed to be talking too much today, but I'm filling in for Father Petris, who was supposed to give the talk this morning. So if you, one of the spiritual works of mercy is to bear patiently with other people. So you have to bear patiently with me. I heard this story from somebody else, so it's not my original story, but the story was that a religious nun, no offense to our nuns, they do great work, but the story was that this nun had the gift of vision. She could see things. And so the news came to the bishop, and the bishop wanted to find out the story about this religious sister with the gift of vision. So she wanted to find out, you know, what's really the truth behind this, whether this is a genuine spiritual gift, or whether the nun might be, you know, something else. So she went to visit sister and to find out whether she had a genuine gift of being able to see things or something else. So she asked the sister in order to find out more about sister. She said, sister, can you, after talking with her, the bishop asked the sister, can you tell me what is the bishop's sin? In other words, my sin. Of course, the bishop knows very well he sins. And it was a good way to find out whether sister really is going to tell the truth or not. So sister said, well, bishop, let me pray about it, and after 2 weeks, you can come back and maybe I can give you an answer about the bishop's sin. So after 2 weeks, the bishop visits sister again and asks sister, well, sister, what have you found out about the bishop's sin? And so sister said, well, bishop, I've been praying about it, and after 2 weeks of prayer, this is what I have to tell you. The bishop's sin, God has forgotten it. Yeah. It's a good answer, but it is also the truth, okay? That God has forgotten our sins. Eh? So this morning we talked about some of the foundations and the key concepts behind the Year of Mercy, according to Pope Francis and according to the Bible, according to theology. Today we want to move forward, and this is also something that Sister Faustina, in her diary, pushed this part of divine mercy, and that is to move towards corporal works of mercy and the spiritual works of mercy, which Cardinal Suani Mafi will talk about tomorrow. So I'd like to just, I want to share with you what I've from this is drawn from the Misericordiae Vultus, or the Bull of Indiction of Pope Francis on the Year of Mercy, and some part of it is drawn from Cardinal Walter Kasper, who also writes about this. This is a book that I'd encourage you to buy, because somebody is speaking on somebody's brain. Either Cardinal Kasper is speaking on Pope Francis' brain, or Pope Francis is speaking on Cardinal Kasper's brain, because you'll find this, explained in both Pope Francis' letter and Cardinal Casper's book, Corporal Works of Mercy and Spiritual Works of Mercy. Okay. Some biblical foundations for the corporal works of mercy. Just goes to show that, you know, this is not just Pope Francis, this is from the Bible, you know. So it puts the ideas of Pope Francis on a wider scope, and that is in the Christian, Judeo-Christian, well, it's more the Christian religion, and that is in the New Testament. And this is good to know that, you know, this is not just something that Pope Francis dreamed about, but it's according to the Bible and the Word of God. In the first letter of St. Peter, it says that, finally, all of you have unity of spirit and sympathy, love for one another, a tender heart and humble mind. So, works of mercy implied there. Paul's letter to the Colossians, it says, and may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, just as we abound in love of you. All these are implying works of mercy. The letter to the Romans, we have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering. So we have the refuge ministry that we've been listening to. We have the deliverance ministry. All these are part of the works of mercy. Teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. Rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. All these are ways of deeds of mercy. And then Paul's letter to the Philippians, for this reason, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty. So, divine mercy saying the chaplet is good, something, but we need something else. And that is what the Bible is saying, and what Pope Francis and what and also the Sister Faustina is saying to us. Paul's letter to the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, and his heart goes out all the more to you as he remembers the obedience of all of you and how you welcomed him with fear and trembling. I was talking, sister who works at the refuge center, the refuge ministry, you know, talks about how they welcomed youths who come into their center, and many of them come with fear and trembling, but in the center they find a place where they can be, they can call home. Hebrews, remember those who are in prison as though you were in prison with them, and those who are being tortured as though you yourselves were being tortured. So again, these are works of mercy that St. Paul talks about. And the great text for our works of mercy is in the Gospel of Matthew, in that parable of in the final judgment on chapter 25 of Matthew's Gospel. But I'm just taking out the heart of that Gospel. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. A stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked. You gave me clothing. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me. So those are what you would say biblical foundations for works of mercy or corporal works of mercy. Okay, corporal, you know, comes from the word corpus, which is, you know, corpus Christi, it means body. So it's works of mercy, physical works of mercy, food, drink, clothing, shelter, all this, like the physical needs of people. These are what you mean by corporal, so bodily needs of the people. So those are biblical texts that refer to corporal works of mercy. And this is something that Sister Faustina in her diary wrote also, that God demanded her of this. So on Sister Faustina's diary, it reads, and God was saying to her this, "My daughter, if I demand through you that people revere my mercy, you should be the first to distinguish yourself by this confidence in my mercy." And the words are very strong. "I demand from you deeds of mercy, works of mercy, which are to arise out of love for me. You are to show mercy to your neighbors always and everywhere. You must not shrink from this or try to excuse or absolve yourself from it." So clear words in the diary about works of mercy. And then the diary continues, that goes to explain three ways of exercising mercy towards your neighbor. First, by deed, works, by word. That'll come in the spiritual works of mercy. And number three, by prayer. So these are three ways that Faustina teaches about the works of mercy. So it is in these three degrees. It's contained the fullness of mercy. It is an unquestionable proof of love for me. So, you know, St. James in the New Testament also talks about a man without good works, his faith is dead, you know. So faith without good works is dead faith. Same thing here, Sister Faustina in her diary is saying, you know. Through these works of mercy is found the proof of your love for me. So in other words, without works of mercy, you know, it's not the whole love that Sister Faustina talks about. So this is another very strong statement in the diary, that works of mercy is to be a reminder of the demands of my mercy, because even the strongest faith is of no avail without works. Re-echoing the words of St. James, faith without good works is dead kind of faith, you know. In the Old Testament, you often hear, you know, God saying, it's not sacrifice I want, but mercy and compassion, you know. So what you have there is a clear reference to the importance of works of mercy from the Bible and from the diary of Sister Faustina. So every person devoted to the divine mercy, and every Christian who bears the name of a Christian and who believes in the God of mercy, how do you find out whether he is a real person of God? It is through his works of mercy, through witnessing to the works of mercy. And again, this is very fundamental, because throughout the Catholic teaching, this runs through the tradition of the Church. Evangelii Nuntiandi, which is the Pope Paul VI's letter on evangelization, talks about, you know, if somebody is converted, it is because somebody witnessed to them that faith, you know. In Evangelii Nuntiandi, it also says that, you know, people are not converted by teachers, but it's because somebody witnessed to them good deeds and works of mercy that a person, that causes conversion. And so this works of mercy, whether you want to call that, or witnessing, is a very fundamental, not only to divine mercy, not only to Sister Faustina, but in the whole Christian tradition. So in the Pope then lists seven corporal works of mercy. Again, you will see that it's based on the Bible, the references that I've listed there, and it's not really something that's totally new. It's something that you already know. But we are, again, the Pope is, in a way, bringing us back to the roots of our faith, to the Bible. So these are the corporal works of mercy: feed the hungry, give drink to the thirsty, clothe the naked, shelter the homeless, welcome the stranger, visit the sick, set free captives, visit the imprisoned, and finally, to bury the dead. These are the seven corporal works of mercy. These are the spiritual works of mercy, but we won't touch that today. Cardinal Murphy is going to speak on that tomorrow. So the spiritual works of mercy are not so much concerned with the things that God doesn't want us to do, the don'ts. Rather, it speaks about the failures that we, the good that we fail to do. So we are familiar with how sin is defined as the sins that we commit. But in the corporal works of mercy and the spiritual works of mercy, we are concerned more with the good that we failed to do. It is concerned with the higher righteousness. For many of us, we are familiar with sin as being that which we commit. But often we not, do not bring in the good that we fail to do. The sick person that I failed to visit, or the poor that I failed to notice, those are also sins. So mercy in the Pope's letter is concerned with more than justice. It's a matter of being attentive and sensitive to the needs of the other. Justice is about what I owe you and what you owe me. So it's like a balance, you know. But here we forget about balancing and all that. We forget the wrong that you have done to me and the hurt that you have done to me. Mercy is driven by the need of that other person. So it expresses God's way of reaching out to the sinner and offering him or her a new chance to look at himself, to convert and believe. And this is taken from Misericordia Vultus, the letter of the Pope to us. So it's a matter of overcoming our self-centeredness that makes us deaf and blind to the physical and spiritual needs of the other. So what drives mercy is, the hurt, the misery, the sinfulness of the other. We forget what that person has done. We believe that that person needs to be delivered, he needs to be loved, and that is what drives mercy. So they are not opposed, justice and mercy, but mercy goes even more, further step, a higher righteousness than justice. The corporal and spiritual works of mercy also correspond to the fourfold forms of poverty. There are four kinds of poverty, and in these corporal works of mercy and spiritual works of mercy, we try to attend to the poverty in the world. And so mercy, one of the underlying motives for mercy is to hear the cry and feel the emptiness of the poor. There are four kinds of poverty, and that is physical or economic poverty, there is cultural poverty, and there is social poverty, and number four, there's mental and spiritual poverty. Physical poverty, we all know that. It means not having the physical needs in life, no house, no food, drink, no clothes, no shelter to protect from natural disasters. So like in Fiji, this is the situation for the, last night I said there was about 45,000 people who are in evacuation centers, meaning they are not staying in their home. And I told you that's half of the Catholic population in Fiji. We are about 80,000 Catholics in Fiji. I just read in the paper today, in the Fiji Times online, that it's risen to 62,000 people who are still living in evacuation centers, either because their house has gone blown away or their house is not fit to be lived in. So this is physical, economic poverty that we talk about to people who have no shelter to protect them from natural disasters. Cultural poverty. Cultural poverty refers to those who are illiterate or have no chance for education or a reduced chance of education because of money in most cases. And because of that, they have a very slim prospect of the future because of the lack of opportunity to be educated. And most of the time it's got to do with the money. And then the third is social poverty, lack of relationships, loneliness, isolation, loss of partner, loss of family members and friends, communication difficulties, exclusion from social interaction, social the social intercourse, but you know, where people come together, especially for us community-based people, like from the islands, this is part of our life. But when we are taken out from this, when you move to the city, when you move to New Zealand, Australia, you know, you find yourself, you know, alone in another culture. And this is one of the causes that will come because of relocation of people, because of rising water level. Also, a lack of exclusion comes from discrimination, marginalization, people who are imprisoned. So all these are forms of social poverty. And then last one is mental and spiritual poverty. So this is a deeper sense of poverty, lack of orientation, the inner emptiness, hopelessness, desolation, despair about the meaning of one's existence. So people are lost, people are in crisis to the point of neglecting one's soul. Like a little bit of like what Zach King's talking about, your soul has no value, you can sell it over to somebody else, to Satan or to some worldly things. So lack of moral and spiritual orientation. So this is the fourth, and in this world today, this is becoming a serious thing, mental and spiritual poverty. So it calls for us as church a response to this poverty. So our Christian response has to be holistic and provide for all dimensions of poverty. We, like famous cardinal, I don't know whether it's a cardinal or bishop, Archbishop from Brazil, Elder Camara. He is often quoted for these words in Brazil. He said, "When I give food to the poor, they call me a saint. But when I speak against social injustice, and speak for the poor and talk to the government and those policy makers about the needs of the poor, they call me a communist. Yeah. So you see two things there. It's, so our helping the poor cannot be, it's good to be charitable. And the government and other, they like the church because we are considered a charitable organization. But when we speak to government about social justice, they don't like that. But that's part of the package of fighting against evil, because that's the root. Because poverty is not only an individual problem, it is a social problem. It has its roots in society, in the failure of society to address the poverty. So our response to poverty cannot be just like a band-aid kind of solution, just to part of it, give food, that's good, provide the hospital, that's good. But we also need to be prophetic. Normally, they like the charitable side of it. They like the St. Vincent de Paul of it, but they don't like the Jeremiah side of it. Then that is to be prophetic. But so our Christian response to poverty through corporal works has to be both corporal and spiritual. Spiritual talks about the need to be prophetic, to speak to the truth. In our Catholic tradition, we have a tool that has been used in many churches and organizations called the pastoral circle. So you can find no time to teach about the pastoral circle here, but it's a tool for pastoral effectiveness that has been used. This is invented, not invented by the Jesuits, but the Jesuits put together the name, but it's built on a longer tradition of Catholic social teaching about making our response effective and touching the root causes of problems in society. And we call that the pastoral school, which integrates social science, social analysis into the church's response. Now, I'd just like to share with you some of the corporal works of mercy in Fiji that we're trying to... I did not know that we are really doing corporal works of mercy until I started to develop my talk. Oh, we're doing something like this in Fiji. So there's four things that I'd like to refer that some of the things that we're trying to do in Fiji. And that is, the first one is small Christian communities. And sometimes they are called the basic ecclesial community. In South America, they call it that. In the Philippines, in Africa, they call it the small Christian communities. In Fiji now, there's we've just said SCCs, which can mean also another thing. That is the Suva City Council. We tell them, we're not talking about the Suva City Council now, that killing up the rubbish in the town. We talk about Bible sharing, which is at the heart of the small Christian community. And so we started this about since I came to office, and I really believe that this is something that is very basic to the church. But at the heart of these small Christian communities, like a neighborhood community, is Bible sharing, gospel sharing every week. And every week they have to choose a word of life. And this word of life often leads to a work of mercy for them during that week. Just 2 weeks before I came here, we had an evaluation of where we are, where the communities are in terms of their small Christian community and how the Bible sharing is going on. I listened to some very wonderful sharing, which is a big inspiration for me. And what I hear is this: now there's a lot of visitation, visiting the poor, visiting those who do not come to church, visiting the prison. More people are coming to church because of the small Christian community in living out their word of the week has challenged them to visit, to care for those who are in the fringes of society. And it's For me, it was a big consolation and an affirmation of the importance of the Word of God in life. Not only like the chaplet, not only reading the Word, but also to live the Word of God. The Pope says that, you know, these works of mercy must be integrated into our church, in what we do in church. So in last year and this year, we were integrated something like this into our Lenten appeal. Before, we just had a Lenten appeal without no real clear objective. For the last 2 years, we focused on one goal in our Lenten appeal, and that is to house the poor. Whatever money that we raise during the Lenten appeal goes to helping build a house for some poor people. So with the Lenten appeal last year, we were able to build two houses for two people who had very poor housing. And that's another good way of integrating works of mercy in the church. So if you are a member of the pastoral council or member of the church ministry, you really can, this is a practical way of bringing the works of mercy into how you run your parish. Then St. Vincent de Paul, as you know, is another group that practices this a lot, but we need to, we have a very, St. Vincent de Paul is a big name, eh? But in Fiji, when you really count the numbers, it's very small. Eh? So we need to really, but they are doing great work. Right now, they're building a new big building for poor homeless people. And then the fourth one, that is a institute, Champagne Institute, that was run by the Maris Brothers, FMS Teaching Brothers, to cater, and this is the only school that caters for handicapped, intellectually handicapped children in Fiji. And they, all schools that are slow learners, slow in the intellectually, they come to this school and catch up on their secondary education. And some of them actually go to secondary education. So this is, these are the culture, this is talking about cultural poverty. So these are some of the works that we do in Fiji as a sign of corporal works of mercy. That's a photo of our small Christian leaders training. We train people to set up the small Christian community. That's the house that we built for that poor family up in the hills, up in Namosi. That woman, her husband died. They have, God bless them, with 8 children. But she's a single mother now. That's a very simple house. That cost about $16,000. Corrugated iron. Okay, that's a St. Vincent de Paul house. That's an old house that's going to be taken down. And then a new house. Those are the members of that. These are homeless people that end up in this house. But their house is now being built due to the generosity of one lady who donated $1 million to build this house. So all they're waiting for their house. That's the construction of the new house going on there, up in Brown Street, for those who are in Fiji. Okay, this is just some photos from the Cyclone Winston. So thank you for your corporal works of mercy, all the collections that you have given, and the collection that you will give tonight and tomorrow. Those kids put together those two sofas and protected themselves in that night, to protect themselves from the hurricane that night. Bring together two sofas, and then they just snuggled inside the underneath that sofa. That's a school, just ripped up. Uh, I don't know how that tree got there, but it's amazing. That is all, gentlemen, and thank you for listening.